Good morning and welcome to today's Pasco County School Board meeting. Now would be a great time for you to check your cell phones and electronic devices and make sure that they are off and on silent. Let me also remind you that face coverings are required while you're in the room. And just as a courtesy to those of you all that are standing, this is probably going to be a long meeting. And there are chairs out in the lobby if you prefer to go, and the sound is on out there. If you prefer to go out there and sit, when we get to a public comment at the end of the meeting, we'll call names. So just wanted to let you know that. Our vision statement is all students achieve success in college, career, and life. And our thought for the day is Cynthia Armstrong.
All right. This is by Albert Hubbard. Says the greatest mistake you can make in life is to be continually fearing that you will make one.
Yes, you would stand and join me for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Let the record reflect that all board members are present, along with the superintendent and our attorney. And today, unfortunately, we will have a moment of silence for the family of Kevin Ellis, a student at Pasco High School. So if you would join me in that, please. Thank you. Board members, we were provided a copy of the minutes of both our regular meeting and our workshop from March the 2nd. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Bodwin, second. I missed by Crumley. All in favor, signify by aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. So today we have one public hearing on exceptional student policies, and I'll turn it over to our attorney.
Thank you. This is to announce a public comment portion of the Exceptional Student Education Policies and Procedures, SPMP 2020-2021 through 2022-2023. Notice of this public hearing has been posted on the district website and publication in compliance with Florida statutes. Any member of the public who wishes to be heard on Exceptional Student Education Policies and Procedures are asked to complete a green speaking request form that you can get from the board secretary. When called, please approach the podium and state your name and address for the record. Each speaker will have 3 minutes to speak unless an extension is granted by the board chair.
Thank you. I've looked through the cards and I see none that are on item 3.1. Is there anybody here to speak to this? All right, so the public hearing is closed now, and we will consider this again at a future meeting. So, is that 15.5?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, I am going to move the speakers for 15.5. We're going to do a presentation on that at the end and then deal with that all at one time. So, that was the only cards that I have that have anything to do with an agenda item. So, we'll move on to 5.2, USEP, Mr. Peace.
Superintendent Browning, Attorney Alfonso, thank you for not making me change my notes. Chair Altman, honorable board members and district staff, good morning. I hope you're all doing well. I come here today troubled because we're at a crossroad. No, not USEP in the district. We agree on things and disagree on things, but we have generally been able to work out our differences. What I'm speaking about is public education in this great state. Public education is at a crossroad because of much proposed legislation being generated in Tallahassee. everything from school board pay, Bright Future scholarships, educational curriculum structure, vouchers, teacher pay, retirement income, and even union membership applications with school district confirmation, I might add, Superintendent, is on the table. There are many possible outcomes that could severely change public education being discussed. This year, it is harder than ever to communicate in any sort of effective manner to legislators. I would urge everyone in this room to be an advocate for public education. Contact our local legislators as well as those committee members hearing bills, especially this week and next. We need to collectively, union members, school board members, superintendents, education employees, and general public, send a clear, loud message to all legislators that education professionals in this state have been asked to give of themselves time and time again to see to it that students are not forgotten, that they get nutritional meals, sound educational opportunity, considerable resources, and maybe most important, social and emotional support. The governor said this is the year of the teacher. With so many punitive and demeaning bills being pushed in committees in this legislative session, it sure doesn't feel like teachers or any education employee is really being appreciated. The governor has done a lot of good things. We have been back in school face-to-face for the better part of a year without major problems. The economy has been revived. Vaccinations are being offered through numerous outlets. And we have been returning slowly and steadily to a pre-COVID world. The governor also recently proposed a $1,000 bonus to principals and teachers for their work over the past year, realizing the many sacrifices that have been made by these folks. I applaud the governor for thinking of these individuals, and I want to believe his intent was well meant. However, his message fell far short of its intended goal. During the fourth quarter of last year, this past summer, and throughout this year, many other individuals also made sacrifices on behalf of students and were not recognized or offered a bonus. Most, if not all of you in this room, were involved in making sure students' needs were met. Feeding, planning curriculum, meeting the health and safety protocols we negotiated, providing technology, contact tracing, and I could go on and on. Many of the employees that performed these tasks were not recognized nor offered even a thank you, let alone a bonus. I want to recognize all of the education employees who took part in some manner to see to it that our students moved forward and were provided with what they required to be educationally, emotionally, socially, and mentally successful and could perform in a safe and healthy environment. Thank you. I think our government and our legislators need to rethink much of what is going on in Tallahassee and work to make public education stronger and its employees prouder for making this our chosen profession. Please be an advocate for public education. Contact our local and state legislators and let them know the impact many of these bills will have on our employees, our students, and their families and the future of education in this state. Before I go, let me say thank you to Superintendent Browning, Mr. Gadd, and Mr. Shibley. They agreed to meet with USEP to discuss some concerns we had. I believe we all came away from that conversation with a plan to move forward with mutual agreement on reconciling the issue. And again, thank you all for what you do.
Thank you, Mr. Peace. Board member committee reports. Ms. Armstrong, we'll start with you today.
Okay, had Employee Health and Wellness Incentive Committee and went over the month-by-month plan of what we're doing to improve employee health. Then also had several legislative meetings with FSBA Just want to say that many of the bills we've been following are continually to go through the committees. Some have House and Senate companions, some don't. But we are setting up, it looks like, for a pretty hefty train education bill. So some of these items could show up on that. One I know that we've been following closely has been the Bright Futures bill that did have some revisions to it, but it is continuing to go through committees. So I think most of the bills that we're concerned with are going through the committees stops and will probably make it to the floor of the House or the Senate. So we're going to have to be very diligent, Mr. P said, in following up with our legislators about which ones are concerning and which ones we want to encourage. There is a bill out there that would provide funding for giving SAT and ACT to all 11th graders. I think that is something that we all agree would be very beneficial to our students. So there are some good things in these bills. We just have to be vigilant. Thank you.
Ms. Crumley?
Okay. I never know what direction you're going these days.
So. Keep y'all on your toes.
Okay. I see that.
And when we get to the other section, I'll switch it around.
That's fine. Okay, first I attended a Pasco Pathways Committee Zoom meeting. Nothing too newsworthy to share with the board, just the same hardworking, diligent team working to streamline school choice and enhance our education options for our students. So I'll keep you posted as things come up. Secondly, I toured the Performing Arts Center with Mrs. Armstrong also and Mrs. Harding over at Cypress Creek Midland High School campus. It's an incredible facility, and the students at Pasco Hernando State College will definitely benefit from this. Also, I also just have to bring up that it is due to the work of Mr. Gadd that we had that land for this facility, and thank you once again because it's an incredible, incredible building. Thank you. And I'm hopeful that there will be many education options there for our K-12 students in the future, and I'm requesting that someone can keep the board updated as these things develop, please. Thirdly, I did tour Day Spring Academy. I was just curious to see how they have converted the clubhouse that they purchased. It's a decades-old clubhouse into classrooms, and they did a great job. I had a very good tour of two campuses. The principal there reported that 90% of their students had returned to in-person learning, and that's all I have to share.
Ms. Harding?
Yes. The Career Technical Education Committee met on March 30th. We discussed the following. Dr. Moore gave our stakeholders a great oversight about what's happening with CTE in Tallahassee during session this year. We went over the executive board and who was elected, and we're still working on fulfilling some of those seats, but we're getting there and just want to make sure that we have strong foundations. There was a career specialist update, and in the month of July, our CTE teachers will be able to partake in a 2.5-day workshop where our stakeholders will be able to speak to them about what each of their industry needs. This is going to be such an awesome opportunity, and we had many of our partners share that they wanted to be a part of it, so that was really encouraging. We then had a discussion about how businesses could play a role in the support of our CTE academies and programs. And throughout the session, our business partners were able to share how they can help advise, assist, and advocate so our students are successful.
Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Bodwin?
The Academia Accreditation Committee met, or the leadership team met, but since that's not a standing committee, I'm going to talk about that in my individual board member report.
Okay. So I had a value adjustment board meeting. We listened to final appeals and settled all of those, and elected officers for the coming year. Commissioner Oakley is the chairman by law. The chairman must be a county commissioner. And then I was elected the vice chair for that, but we renewed all the contracts and there were no additional changes this time. We had a insurance trust fund meeting, continuing to deal with the I guess I'm trying to say delicately how to say this, the continued number of fraudulent claims being presented by attorneys around the state and the impact that it's having on municipalities and school districts and others, and some legislation that we're following to try to hopefully deal with some of that, but it's encountered some turbulence in the House, so I'm not sure where that's going to go. And then tomorrow, all day, we have a construction management meeting selecting construction manager for the next school they're going to be redoing, and so we'll be working on that all day tomorrow. So with that, we move on to the superintendent for comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members. As you're aware, last Wednesday, I announced that the district would no longer be offering the My School Online option when school starts back in August. As of Wednesday, 76.15% of our students were already attending bricks and mortar classrooms. While the My School Online option served our students during the COVID pandemic, it's time to get our students back in the classroom. Our data shows that a good number of our students using this option are not being successful academically. They need to be in a classroom with a great teacher in front of them. Additionally, I and staff are very concerned about the social-emotional health of our students, and our students need to be with other students. Our students need to be involved with their clubs and other school activities. The mental health of our students certainly is a critical concern as we move forward. Returning back to the classroom will certainly help anchor our students into some sense of normalcy. We'll continue to monitor our progress as we approach the new school year. We'll see if I can read this without my fogged up glasses. As you may be aware, Pasco County government announced yesterday that the mask requirement was being lifted. With that said, Pasco District will continue to follow the governor's executive order permitting the wearing of masks until the expiration of the order on April 26th, or unless the order is revoked or extended. Once the mask requirement is lifted, which I anticipate sometime around April 26th, masks will be optional. Staff and students that want to wear a mask will certainly be allowed to do that. Personally, I don't care to wear my mask, but I choose to follow the requirements to mask up. The wearing of mask not only helps protect you or me, but also those that I come in contact with each and every day. We'll certainly continue to monitor infection rates and take appropriate steps to ensure the safety of our students and staff. As you are also aware, or may be aware, the district has held several vaccination clinics for our employees, with the probable last clinic being held on Saturday, April 17th. We have, as of now, fully vaccinated over 3,000 staff members. I will tell you that this would not have been possible without the leadership of several staff members in this district. And I always hate starting to mention names, but I'm going to mention a few names. Melissa Musselwhite, I cannot begin to thank Melissa for her Herculean efforts to get these clinics organized and managed. I can't thank her enough. Janine Welch, same thing. Those two work hand in hand in SSPS to ensure that those clinics are well done. Amy Ponce, our supervisor of school health, and then Jessica Chevaletto, who happens to be our occupational health nurse that we recently hired from within the district. And I will tell you, literally a cast of 100 plus that have pulled these clinics off. I don't know what most other districts are doing, but I've not heard a lot from other districts about any vaccination efforts. But if we want to have a return safe to school, I believe that we need to make sure that our employees and at the appropriate time our students that choose to be vaccinated are given that opportunity to be vaccinated. And it cannot happen without the ones I mentioned and literally hundreds of other people throughout this district that pulled these off. Our school nurses, LPNs, students, district staff, and others have worked tirelessly to ensure a safe and efficient opportunity for our staff to get vaccinated. Obviously, you hear about all the long lines, people having to wait to get vaccinated. It probably took longer for folks to sit and wait after the vaccination, which is about 15 minutes, than it did to get out of your car, get in, get registered, and get vaccinated. And it was very, very quick and very efficient. And keep in mind that while all these vaccination clinics were being organized and conducted, our normal work continued. And that did not go undone. I can't thank the entire team enough for their commitment to our district and these clinics. I also want to draw your attention to our workshop immediately after the meeting today. Staff will be presenting the reading adoption to the board, the K-12 reading adoption, as well as the CTE adoption. Staff throughout the district have literally been working on this adoption for close to a year now. It has been a huge undertaking, and staff has done an exceptional job with it. Many times after hours, but the untold hours that have gone into this, and you will see that today, and I'm confident that it will be timely and informative. Finally, I'm requesting the board to take an off-agenda item for an early childhood grant. This item will become item 15.6 if you choose to take it up. Mrs. Hilton provided additional information to the board yesterday, and will be more than happy to address any questions you might have during her time on the agenda today. That's all I have, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you. Before I go to Mr. Gadd, just let me piggyback on that. I happened to be at a function Saturday evening, had a good conversation with the State Education Commissioner, Senator, and two or three representatives, and I was just really, really pleased with the comments from all of those people about Pasco County and how our district has responded. They were extremely complimentary of our staff and how they've dealt with things. And I actually had one of them tell me that even the people in their county, they weren't from here, even the people in their county were telling them that Pasco County was the go-to county, the leader in accomplishing all of this stuff. So for all of you that are here today and all those that are listening, thank you on behalf of the board. You have done yeoman's work, and it has been recognized statewide. So I want to take that opportunity to say thank you for that. Mr. Gadd?
I just wanted to make one quick comment related to something Ms. Crumley spoke about. She talked about during day spring.
Can you come to the podium, please?
Yeah. wanted to remind the board that we're the only district in the state that I know of that has an interlocal agreement with the county that allows the school board to do all the permitting for charter schools if they opt in. So one of the things that helps Day Spring when they're doing a remodel job or they're building a new building is they don't have to go through the county for permitting. Our new construction department helps them with their permitting, moves things along. If there's a permitting problem, we don't just walk away and come back in 3 weeks. We tell them what they need to fix, and we come back the next day so that they can move things along. During the COVID pandemic, Mr. Legg and I had lots of communication because they were trying to find new classrooms, spread kids out, do social distancing. They had an old building. Our new construction team went in, helped redesign a particular space, ran interference for them with the county, assisted them in getting into that new space. And we have done a lot of that kind of work with Day Spring, but we've also done it with Academy at the Farm and other schools. And it is unique in the state that we offer that service. And the county allowed us to take over that permitting, and we have a very unique relationship with a lot of charter schools, and in particular Day Spring, where they avail themselves of our services on a regular basis, and it's made all the difference in our relationship. And probably every 2 weeks I'm talking to Day Spring about something going on relative to their instruction or relative to educational issues that we talk about relative to programmatic concerns. So it's been a great relationship.
Thank you. All right, we're going to flip staff today too. Dr. Skanger, you get to go first.
I'm special today. And I'm going to introduce somebody really special, too. I'm here to introduce Melissa Jarvis, if you'll stand, please. We're recommending Melissa to be the next principal at Trinity Oaks Elementary School, where Allison Hoskins opened the school and was there up till recently. And Allison went over to Odessa. Mrs. Armstrong, when you read your quote this morning, not afraid to make mistakes, I thought that was very fitting because this is a quote from Melissa. She wants to create a dynamic learning environment where risks are taken, status quos are challenged, and students advanced at high rates. So I don't think she's going to be afraid to make a mistake, and I like that about her. Melissa started as a teacher at Fox Hollow Elementary School 17 years ago, and she's been in our district ever since. She was an AP at Gulfside, and most recently an AP at Mary Giella Elementary School. So it's my honor to recommend her to be the next principal of Trinity Oaks Elementary School. With her is her daughter, Haley, who recently graduated from UCF, and her son, Michael, who recently graduated from UF. So that's they're both wonderful state universities, and congratulations to them.
Congratulations. Thank you. Dr. Skang, anything else? All right. Dr. Isles.
Good morning, everyone. You may remember at a recent board workshop, we talked about the need to start credit recovery at an earlier grade level than waiting until 12th grade. So you will see in your board packet in 11.3, we've asked for an increase in expenditure with our contract with Apex, and it is extending course recovery from 7th through 12th. It allows unlimited access for all of our schools. Additionally, it also allows standard-based recovery as well. Also, this morning, I've asked Mrs. Samantha DeValle to come in. We recognize that there's lots of information that parents are faced with when their students come into high school. And our student progression plan is what guides us in this work, but it's not really written in parent-friendly language. And so Mrs. DeValle had a committee get together and has put together a web page that we would like to promote to our parents to share some more information about the high school experience.
Good morning. As Dr. Isles said, on the screen, you'll see the web page that we worked on. I want to give a thank you before I start to OSSPS, OLL staff, CTE staff, and Amy Mazurowski, who helped us put this together. On this front page, I'm just going to kind of navigate through each page, and we will have a next iteration of this for middle school and elementary. We broke it into 7 tabs, as you'll see, so high school graduation, our diploma designations, scholarship and financial aid, actions to stake at each grade level, supports at each high school, our Pasco Pathways opportunities, and then post-secondary opportunities. So Andy, if you'll click on the first one, high school graduation. So this one really overviews student progression. So like Dr. Isles said, the student progression plan is a great document. It encompasses a lot of information, but it's not always the most easy to read, and it's very long. So we chunked it out into what is most important for parents to know, the diploma requirements from the state, our graduation options and credits, GPA, tests required for graduation, and then ACT and SAT. If you'll click on ACT and SAT, that bottom one, you'll see that this being at the same time as our college and career fair has really kind of dovetailed nicely together because we're able to use all of the recordings that our career specialists and counselors did to add these to the website for parents. Additionally, at the bottom where it says student progression and course selection, if you can click on catalog and then navigate to the high school categories. This is just something I wanted to highlight. OLL and also CTE has worked on a course catalog that's parent-facing, so it has everything that's available in our district, and electives will be added in as well. We're working on that now, but it gives parents information that they might be interested in for courses and how they plan for college. So if you want to click on, if you wouldn't mind clicking on English 1, Andy, that's a good example. It's up a little bit.
English 1?
Yes. right at the top. Yep, there you go. So each course is set up to tell them, does it meet college entrance requirements? Does it meet Bright Futures, NCAA, but then also the resources that we use, what does the course encompass, and lots of other helpful information. So if parents ever have questions about courses, this is a place that we can send them for middle and high. If we can navigate back, Andy, to the next screen tab, the diploma designations. So this one breaks down just what are the designations that you can get when you graduate for scholar designation, merit, and the Florida Seal of Biliteracy, which are from the state, but then also outlines our requirements as a county for valedictorian and salutatorian. So kind of a one-stop place to find out all of that information. And then the next green tab, which is scholarships and financial aid, definitely a huge kudos to OSSPS for their work and CTE on this. It has the database where they can find all scholarships available, information on financial aid, tons of helpful information on Bright Futures. So as parents are meeting with counselors, it will be a nice resource and career specialist for them to take with them home and to navigate for future planning. The next one is student success by grade level. And each, if you want to just click on ninth grade, Andy, thank you. Each grade has milestones, readiness, things that parents would want to know as they're saying, at the end of ninth grade, where should my student be? In 10th grade, what should I anticipate? And this is one that Amy Mazurowski worked on and is very helpful, I think, to everyone, just as you're having conversations for 8th graders entering high school or current high school students. Additionally, the next one are supports that we offer at all of our high schools that we may not have all had in one place just because they vary by department. So we put everything here and different contact information that parents can and students can have may they need these services. So all of those are drop downs with additional information. And then for Pasco Pathways, as we think about our catalog, we broke that down, but also put in all of our recordings from the expos in one place as well. So when you're thinking about high school and planning for ninth grade, what are courses I might want to take? What is a program that I may want to enter? Or what CTE options are available at my school? So those are all there as well. And then last but not least, we have post-secondary options. So as they're planning with their counselor, which starts very early, for what happens after high school, maybe they're thinking about careers they're interested in, self-exploration. Lots of questions we get about collegiate athletics. So that presentation is there. And then there's different tabs you'll see at the top for the different state colleges, community colleges, military, workforce, and great information in each of those. So like I said, it was definitely a cross-departmental effort, but I think this will be a nice place for parents to come to find it all together. And thank you for Dr. Isle for asking us to work on this. Thank you for your time.
Outstanding work.
That's really awesome. Good.
Thank you. Very, very good information. Dr. Isle, anything else? All right, Mrs. Poe.
Good morning. I always love getting to share with you our wonderful business partners who support our work on a daily basis. It truly does take a village. And this year, more than any other, it has been definitely high on our priority list to keep our culture and climate as positive as possible in the year of COVID. And to do that this year, we had several business partners that stepped up. We know that they're very involved in our schools, and our principals and our assistant principals are working hard to keep that culture and climate positive for their teachers and staff. But we're here to also keep that culture and climate high for our school administrators. So at the elementary level, our theme this year was our story, and it was all about making this year a positive story for all involved. And doing that, we were able to provide masks and t-shirts for every elementary principal and assistant principal, and that was made possible by donations by the Education Foundation, the Pasco Educational Foundation, and my mother-in-law, Anna Poe, so I wanted to thank those sponsors. We also had Gary Cucci from Horace Mann Insurance and Publix also donate so that we could just keep those little culture boosters going all year long. Mr. Cucci actually just donated 20 $25 gift cards for our Lucky Duck campaign, where 20 assistant 20 administrators, one principal and assistant principal from each school when their lucky duck was drawn. Gary actually donated those and delivered them, so he went out to our schools and was able to present those lucky duck winners with the $25 gift cards, and we got such a great response from the administrators, just lifting their spirits throughout the year. But again, it takes all of us working together to do that. Also, I came to you earlier in the year and talked about Rotary of Dade City donating books to our Dade City schools. Well, this week we are actually going out with the, I want to make sure I get it right, it is the Rotary Club of Zephyr Hills Daybreak, and they are donating books to Chester Taylor Elementary, West Zephyr Hills Elementary, and Woodland Elementary. And the members who reached out to us were Jody Wilkinson, Christian Robin, Manny Funes, and Teresa Peacock. And they are going to meet us at each of the schools this week so that we can present them with that generous donation. So we just want to give kudos and thanks to all of our business sponsors, including the Rotary of Zephyr Hills. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Hexler-Nettles.
Good morning. Piggybacking on Ms. Poe's support from the community, I placed a proclamation at each of your desks and wanted to share with you that Zephyr Hills recently extended some thanks to Raymond B. Stewart Middle School, and Mayor Gene Whitfield and the Zephyr Hills City Council recognize the challenging year that they have faced for learning, academics, and sports. They recognize several of their teams, including girls and boys basketball and the football teams, and all of those coaches involved. And then primarily Principal Shay Davis for her exceptional leadership and support. The city is very proud of Raymond B. Stewart Middle School and recognize them publicly with that proclamation. At Rushi Middle School, I have several student celebrations to share with you. I actually was at the school the day that the Reflections County winners were announced, and it was really neat to see in person and my school online students being recognized for their creative talents. The first place winner in literature was Bianca Horodecki. The music composition was awarded to Reese Whitney Van Brocklin, and the first place dance competition was Mackenzie Curtis. All three of those students are advancing to the state level. And also at Charles S. Rushi Middle School, if you have not seen, Miss Eliza Lammers, a seventh grader, recently won a national competition, an award in C-SPAN student cam competition. Students around the country created documentaries on a variety of issues, and Ms. Lammers submitted a documentary on maternal mortality in the United States. She submitted it to C-SPAN and was shocked to hear she won third place among hundreds of entrants across the country. So congratulations to Eliza, and a special thanks to her civics teacher, Mr. Anthony Engel, for supporting that project. I would also like to congratulate some John Long Middle School students. We recently had a team there that placed first in the HOSA Florida State competition in the teamwork category. The ladies did a project called Exploring Medical Innovation, and it was a project on 3D bioprinting. So Madison Bradford, Amrita Vaca, and Rishvika Arakata are headed to an international HOSA leadership conference, which will be held at the end of June virtually. Congratulations, and we're proud of them. Our Pineview Middle School MYP students are demonstrating their caring IB tenet this month as a culminating project of their community projects. They work in teams. There was a group of three young ladies who collected and donated over 100 newborn and preemie infant clothing items to the NICU unit at All Children's Hospital. And we also had a team of three young men who collected dog treats and foods and donated those to the Pasco County Animal Services. So we're very proud of their caring actions on display. Hudson Academy recently hosted their induction ceremony for what will be the new Hudson Academy. You know, last year they did their inaugural Cambridge induction ceremony. So this year they had another inaugural as they anticipate moving back to their home campus in the fall. The smiling, bright, shining faces of the new inductees were just special and such a really momentous occasion for them. And I thank the board for their support. Ms. Harding, I know you attended, and Superintendent Browning as well, so thank you for doing that virtually. And finally, we are all recognizing together this week, we're joining the National Association of Secondary School Principals to recognize our assistant principals, as this is Assistant Principals Week. Our Pasco County assistant principals are second to none. We are grateful for their dedication and leadership, and we just want to say thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Hilton?
Good morning, everybody. As you know, April is Financial Literacy Month, and a couple of years ago, in response to data from our families, our community, we launched an intense effort to support financial literacy in our schools. And so you'll find resources and aligned standards in the learning networks, specialized tasks for use during this month, and this year, a month-long virtual expo supported by some of our great community partners. We're hosting sessions like creating a financial plan, student loans, paying taxes. And so I know those topics in particular are of great interest to the board. Be sure to check out our posters that are around or the OLL website to learn more. You may remember that the state science fair or STEM fair this year is virtual. We held our fair virtual as well. Our district science team recently opened up building 2 for those state scientists competing at the state level to come in and have quiet time and also be supported with some technical assistance prior to their state virtual judging interview. Very exciting. There will actually be a state virtual award ceremony this week. It's actually tomorrow night, and so fingers crossed for our Pasco scientists. Thank you for supporting that. I know Mr. Browning already mentioned the vaccine clinic, but I wanted to put a couple more numbers in front of you. On Friday, as he mentioned, hundreds of volunteers helped vaccinate actually 1,831 staff. That includes subs, retirees, law enforcement, private and charter school employees. And so that brought our total to 3,004 vaccines to date. And as mentioned, we have one more date scheduled April 17th. And we already have 1,168 staff registered so far. There's a few more days open for that. And a huge thank you to Melissa and her team. New work that we never thought that we would have to say, vaccination clinic, but we are saying that often now. I'm also pleased to share with you that our district's commitment to social-emotional learning through compassionate schools is being recognized this week at the state level through the Florida CEL Collaborative. Our Pasco team will present to other districts, highlighting our standards, our benchmarks, and teaching practices, and we would not be so far in this work without your support, so thank you for that. I also would want to talk to you a little bit about early literacy. In response to the board's requests and community interests, we have been expanding our VPK sites. This has been incredibly successful this year at 7 schools, and we also recently opened the applications for 5 new sites for the 2021-22 school year, bringing that total to 12 new, and we have 4 sites full already. Great interest, and that was in a very short amount of time. Additionally, last week you may have seen our curbside with Clifford event at Fox Hollow Elementary School, serving nearly 200 children with books, snacks, gift cards, all supported by community partners. This week you could spot Clifford at Ronnie V. Cox Elementary School on Thursday evening, this time serving all children in that community from pre-K to 5th grade, an event you would not want to miss. And lastly, we do have representatives here from Charter School USA and Union Park Charter School to represent item 15.5. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Moore.
Good morning, board members. Welcome to spring. We are excited for the close of the school year to come. As Ms. Hetzler-Netto said, April 5th through the 9th is National Assistant Principal Week, and we want to celebrate the hard work and dedication of our assistant principals. Their commitment to our students is critical to our success, and we just say thank you for their hard work. I'm also excited to share with you a few highlights from our career in technical and adult education family. As Ms. Hetzer Nettles said, we had three students from Dr. John Long Middle School place first in the HOSA Florida State competition. And I want to say thank you for pronouncing the names, because I had the phonetic spelling here. You did a much better job. But I also want to thank the teacher, the amazing Ms. Livedahl, who is their instructor and leads those students. Also want to let you know that our certified nursing assistant program that is at Marchman Technical College has been approved. In addition to that, the Florida Department of Health has extended the emergency order that suspends the skills testing for our CNA students through June 30th of 2021. Now, what does that mean? It means that our students will be able to finish their program this school year and are only required to sit for the written portion of the license exam. So we are preparing our labs to make sure that we can offer this test to our students and giving them every opportunity that they need to be successful, which will give them the opportunity to enter into the workforce. Want to let you know that Marchman Technical College and Wendell Crin will be hosting a spring virtual open house on April the 13th for all incoming high school students. And if you're available, you're more than welcome to attend. As I stated, CNA program license has been granted to Marchman Technical College by the Florida Board of Nursing. And then to close, you know, our goal for career technical education programs is always to meet the needs of our Pasco businesses. So I am very excited to share that on April 1st, five students from Marchman Technical College signed their letter of intent to work with APG Electric. These students will begin working in May after graduation. In addition, the students will also begin an apprenticeship program in the fall with the independent electrical contractors. So workforce development is our focus, and we're excited to congratulate these students. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Moore. Mrs. Kuhn.
Good morning. Wanted to share with you that we had our first meeting with Pasco County for the joint use of the Starkey Ranch K through 8 Theater Library and Culture Center, and that meeting went very well. We had representatives from the school district, from the school, from the district office, and then also from the county. And it seemed, you know, when this agreement was entered into in 2013, it was so far away, and now it's here, and we're very excited for that and all the work that is to come. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Shibley.
Good morning, board members. There is an addendum to item 10.1 that has been uploaded into the board packet for your approval. Other than that, we are in the throes of the budgeting and allocation process, and we'll actually start conversations with principals next week about staffing for next year. So we will keep the board apprised as we move forward with that process. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Swenson. All right. Thank you. Board members, we move on to the consent agenda. 7.1, anybody have anything they want to pull? I'll entertain a motion then.
Move to approve.
Second.
With addendum of 10.1 included, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. So we move along to our action agenda, and the first one is 15.1, our legislative platform. I'll ask Ms. Armstrong if she has any additional comments, or are we good to go?
No, I think this is a platform that we workshopped, and I want to thank Mr. Haggerty for putting wordsmithing it and making it sound like a platform, but I think it represents us well. I'd entertain any comments from any member if they feel anything needs to be changed. Okay, I think we're ready for a vote. I move approval of our platform.
And second.
So a motion by Armstrong, second by Crumley. All in favor signify by
aye. Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. 15.2, proclamation. I'm going to ask Ms. Bodwin to read that.
Thank you. I want to read this into the record because I visited Kate Fletcher's civics class at John Long Middle School along with Commissioner Mike Moore on Social Emotional Learning Day, March 26th. So I wanted to make sure that we acknowledge them because they wanted to be here for this proclamation, but they could not be. So with John Long Middle School students in mind and all our students, the proclamation recognizing March 26, 2021 as International Social Emotional Learning Day. Whereas Pasco County Schools commits to educating the whole child to ensure all students learn to think critically and solve complex problems while also becoming compassionate human beings and to ensure that our students have the skills they need to become responsible and contributing members of our society. And whereas social-emotional skills include the knowledge, attitudes, and skills necessary for students to recognize and control their emotions and behaviors, establish and maintain positive relationships, make responsible decisions, and solve challenging situations, and set and achieve positive goals. And whereas learning social-emotional skills helps to create a safe and inclusive learning environment for each student and adult in our district. Whereas social-emotional learning is essential for all students in the Pasco County Schools as part of a well-rounded education. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed by the District School Board of Pasco County that March 26, 2021 be observed as Social-Emotional Learning Day in Pasco County Schools and urges all citizens to join in this special observance. So move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion by Bowden, a second by Harding. All in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. We move to 15-3, the STEM conversion and school closure affecting Centennial Elementary and James Marlowe.
Move to approve.
Motion by Crumley.
Second.
Second by Bodwin. Any discussion? Ms. Harding.
Yes. Just wanted to make a few comments. Unfortunately, due to timing, the workshop that I had requested about this could not happen, but I did spend a long time with Superintendent Browning, Greg Gadd, and staff discussing the details of the STEAM schools that we are going to be creating. The first thing that I was concerned about was our teachers and staff, and Mr. Browning told me that and made clear that teachers and staff will have the opportunity to interview and either be placed at Marlowe or Centennial, or the district will provide them with placing them somewhere else. I was also concerned about the professional development and the trainings that staff would get, and staff that was there that talked with me was so informative and assured me that our teachers and staff will be attending professional development this summer as well as into the 21-22 school year. The second concern that I brought up was the fact that our students at these schools will have to choice in, and it was very important that our existing students had the opportunity to attend. Mr. Browning made it very clear to me that when we rezone, we will have priority preference for attendance being given to existing students at both schools. So I want to thank you for that, Mr. Browning. I would also like to request that there is some sort of informational night for our families at these schools. I know the district and the schools have been communicating, and I really thank you for that. I think that a meeting of some sort would really be beneficial to these communities so that our families know what is to come in the following school year. So if we could make something like that happen, I would be really appreciative of that. And I just want to finish with how grateful I am for the opportunity that we're creating for our students in these communities. And I want to thank everyone who has been involved because I'm so, so excited to see it unfold.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Ms. Bowden.
Thank you. We've been talking about this for a number of years, and families have consistently provided feedback indicating there's a high level interest in STEAM schools. So I'm glad that we are expanding this opportunity to the east and west side of the county. Although I do want to say that I believe that our traditional elementary schools are excellent options. I know this is something that parents want.
Okay. Any additional comment? That we have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. 15-4, the Achieve Center of Pasco closure movement of those students.
I'll move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Bowden, second by Armstrong. Any discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. We go to 15-5, the charter school renewal for Union Park. I felt over the weekend, quite frankly, that it was obvious that a lot of people had inaccurate and incomplete information. So I have asked that staff present some information today on that. And then we'll do public comment. I will go ahead and warn those of you, we have more cards than we have time allotted, so you may want to think about making your comments a little briefer or seconding others that are made when we get to that point. So, Superintendent, I'll turn it over to you, and then the appropriate staff can address the issues that parents have raised.
And thank you for that, because I was going to ask for clarification. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members. There apparently has been an email writing campaign going on because my inbox has been filled up, which is more than fine. But again, the tone of the emails are that we're getting ready to close Union Park Charter School, and that is the furthest thing from the truth. It is not the intent of this superintendent or district to close a charter school. There are some concerns. Every year, we do an annual charter school review of all of our charters. We don't single charter schools out. We review everyone annually, and it's just not one person, but it's individuals with expertise in those areas that take specific areas of that review. This district, this superintendent, is not questioning the academic accomplishments of Union Park. Union Park did receive one A grade during the 18-19 school year. That's the only A they've received. There were no grades assigned during the 19-20 for Union Park nor any other school in the state because of where we found ourselves with COVID. And we are getting ready to enter the testing season, and it is still in the air whether or not the state will assign letter grades to schools, including charter schools. That also being the case, of all the different criteria that we looked at, there were four areas that did not meet the standards. All four of those were dealing with a financial condition of the charter school. And I will tell you that as a superintendent of this district, the question might be asked, well, if it's an A school, and why should you be concerned about internal accounting or budgeting principles at a charter school? Well, simply because that should long-term the charter school, any charter school, go into what we would call financial receivership because of no money and they are spending more money than they're bringing in, then there's an obligation on the part of this district to assume the responsibilities and liabilities of those of that charter school. There will be people out there that will say, well, that would never happen. Well, that's fine, but right now I have a fiduciary responsibility to this district to ensure that our charter schools are financially sound and academically sound. So that being said, my recommendation to this board is that you would extend or renew their contract for a term of 1 year so that they and we can have more conversations about things that we believe should be in place in order to right their financial house. So what I would like to do at this time, Mr. Chairman, if I may, is ask Mr. Youngman, the guy in our district that deals with charter schools, to come up and kind of fill in the rest of the missing story, and then we'd be more than happy to take any questions from the board.
Thank you. Good morning, Board Chair, School Board members, Superintendent Browning, Attorney Alfonso. Under this agenda item, the charter contract renewal evaluation of indicators has been submitted for Union Park Charter Academy. The contract end date is June 30th, 2021. Based on an extensive review on the previously submitted charter schools annual, based on the previously submitted charter schools annual review 2019-20 and indicators contained in this packet, there are four noted areas under the category of does not meet the standard. These items are 2D, 2F, 3A, and 3B. All of these indicators pertain to the financial solvency and stability of the organization. The charter school has submitted school comments, which are included in this document. In summary, the finance review noted that the charter school has not achieved a balanced budget in either of the two completed years of operation, 2018-19 and 19-20. In 2018-19, the first year of operation, the charter school had $1,235,595 in total net deficit position. the school had more debt related to capital assets than it had in capital assets. For the 2019-20 fiscal year, the school had $1.6 million in net deficit position. Of that, $1.8 million was invested in capital assets, meaning that the debt related to the capital assets was much higher than the capital assets themselves. The response received from the district pointed out that the depreciation and non-cash expense and eliminating that item would cause the school to end with a positive fund balance excluding the restricted items. However, looking at the analysis and depreciation eliminated, in 2019, charter school overspent $1.2 million. The depreciation was $381,000. Eliminating depreciation would not have resulted in a positive fund balance. For 2020, the charter school overspent $378,000. The depreciation was $545,000. Eliminating the depreciation would have resulted in a positive fund balance for that year of $137,000, but the negative fund balance from the prior year would still cause a negative fund balance for the 2020 year. So that calculation of the net position without depreciation expense over the two-year period in restricted items would be $686,679 net deficit. The charter school pointed out that the auditor, the independent auditor, reviewed conditions for financial emergency under 218.503 Florida statute. This analysis looks at specific conditions and whether or not they have occurred, such as missing bond or tax payments, or missing payroll, or withheld employer tax deposits. This analysis does not measure the overall solvency and stability of the organization. Additionally, this finance reviewer found no budgetary amendments for either fiscal year 18-19 or 19-20, which is required by State Board Rule 6A 1.006. The charter school has stated that the management company conducts reforecasting, but this is not evident in the form of any budgetary amendments. Finally, as provided under Exhibit 3, page 41, the charter school is currently operating at 54% of their enrollment capacity as designated in their charter contract, or alternatively, 77% of the building capacity. The charter school has also experienced a decrease in enrollment from 1920 to 2021 in the amount of 41 students. Overall, due to these factors and under this district's obligation as sponsor, we would not be prudent to recommend a term other than 1 year, considering there are unresolved financial issues that are considered signal signs for distress that may jeopardize the financial viability and sustainability of the charter school. It is also important to note that these are impactors to the sponsor if the school would cease to operate due to self-termination, closure, or non-renewal. These impactors involve student displacement and financial determinations as part of closure. Yesterday, we did have a conference call with the management company. Although we received some documentation for further review, we have not received documented assurances to resolve these concerns. And we have the management company available here and governing board chair for questions too as well.
All right. Thank you. We'll entertain public comment on this, and then we'll afterwards open it up for board members for questions. And there are additional staff, including the auditors and those that have been meeting with them that are here if you have any questions, okay? So I'm going to apologize right up front for some of these names. I've looked through three or four of them, and I can't read the writing exactly clear, so you all will forgive me, but I'm gonna call them in the order in which they were provided to me. So it looks like the first one is Millie Bagley. Was I anywhere near close?
And if I could just add, when you come
up. Oh, I forgot. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Go ahead. Give your speech.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. My fault.
Thank you. When you come up, you will have 3 minutes in duration, and I will serve as the timekeeper. to speak, you should have already given your information to the staff member in the lobby to fill out a card. If you do have materials you wish to share with the board, please email them to the board secretary for distribution after the meeting. Speakers will be called to come forward by the chair prior to making your remarks. Please state your name and address for the record. All speakers and comments are subject to applicable school board policies regarding civility and decorum. And I would also note that there were two Let's Talk comments received on agenda item 15.5, which have already been forwarded to the board members for consideration and which shall be referenced as part of the minutes of this meeting.
All right, thank you. And she said 3 minutes, but we have I counted over 30 cards before some more were handed to me, and we have an hour set aside for public comments. So I'm going to ask you just voluntarily to please keep your comments to 2 minutes or less. So was that Mike? I'm sorry, my apologies. Come on, Mike. So remember, name and address for the record, please.
Mike Bagley, 9336 Mandrake Court, Tampa, Florida, 33647. So I have some comments that I prepared, but after listening to the review just recently, a few minutes ago, I don't know how applicable these are. So I may interrupt a little bit through and go to some of the observations that I just realized that we may be talking about. So again, my name is Mike Bagley, and currently I have 3 boys in Union Park. We've been there since the doors opened in 2018, and at that time, Jaden, my oldest, was in 5th grade. At the beginning of the school year, he had what seemed to be an insurmountable amount of math homework every day. And my wife and I reached out to his teachers and requested a conference to receive answers to our questions. During this conference, they told us that Jaden and several other students weren't up to the level where they needed to be for 5th grade, and that his previous school didn't adequately prepare him academically, especially in math. By the end of the first quarter, they worked with him and us to bring him to grade level, at which time he began to thrive. Jaden is now in 7th grade, is taking 9th grade algebra, where he maintained a B average for the year so far, and is taking another high school credited course where he's learning an A, and all the other classes he's enrolled in are advanced classes where he is also maintaining an A in each of those classes. Landon, my second oldest, has a more reserved and quiet personality. He has really blossomed at Union Park and has developed his self-confidence by discovering his passion for computer coding. Pre-COVID, Union Park offered an after-school coding club beginning in 3rd grade. We've learned that many other schools in the area don't offer coding or clubs until 5th grade. Because clubs aren't currently available at the school due to COVID, we have enrolled Landon in a local coding school for youth, as he has wanted to continue to code. In fact, my mom visited during spring break, and as Landon was proudly showing her the projects that he had created, he told her in his own words that he really loves coding. Discovering this passion while at Union Park has allowed him to develop his previously unknown talent. So we feel that Union Park, our kids aren't just another number. And after listening to the previous analysis, it sounds like some of the concerns are financially based, attendance based. Hopefully we take into consideration COVID as part of the 2020, the decrease of attendance by, I think it was over 40%. Hopefully that's taken into consideration. Also, last year, about this time, Ms. Morales was promoted to principal, which you can see already in the financial statements. It sounds like had some of the things not carried forward from 2019 under the previous leadership, the school possibly could have been in the black. Having worked and been around Ms. Morales for the past 3 years and now getting to know Ms. Land, I have no doubt that the school is in a positive direction, will continue to head that way under their leadership. And so I encourage you, as my boys would if they were here, to extend Union Park's charter for the next 5 years. Thank you.
So Kelly Mongan, it looks like, and then next, Deandra Bolden. And then after that will be Gladys George.
I feel like I'm in church. My name is Kelly Mon. I live at 8505 Zapota Way, Tampa, Florida, 33647. Union Park, I'm sorry, I'm emotional, has really blessed my family. I had I have 3 children that attend there. 2 of them had attended other schools in the past, and we're not thriving at all. My oldest was told that he will never be above a C, and that's all he will ever get. And we went to Union Park, and As Mike Baglia said, all the kids came in at different levels. They had kids that were above level, they had kids that were way below, and by the end of the first semester, all kids were where they needed to be at the end of fifth grade. Since then, my oldest, who was told he'd never be above a C average, is now making A's and B's, and he has truly thrived at Union Park. My other son, on the other hand, had estropia with convergence, and they were willing to work with him. The teachers actually recommended, hey, bring in a yoga ball. What school actually will allow you to do that? And they let him bring in a yoga ball, and it helped him to focus because he had to deal with his convergence on his eyes and learning his eyes were not processing and bringing in the information to his brain as he needed. He started with D's and F's. He is now making A's and B's. Union Park has been a blessing to our family. My daughter absolutely loves it. And with these, I pray that thou will consider making it a little bit longer. Thank you.
Thank you. Deandra Bolden. Followed by Gladys George, followed by Valerie Cole.
We're nice.
I'm not scared. Good morning, everybody. My name is DeAndre Bolden. My daughter is a sixth grader at Union Park Charter Academy.
DeAndre, I'm sorry to interrupt you. I need your address, buddy.
Oh, 4835 White Sanderling Court. It says 4874 Wandering Way on the card.
All right.
My daughter's a sixth grader at Union Park Charter Academy. She's been there ever since the school started a couple years ago. She loves it at the school. She loves her friends. She loves her teacher. She loves all of the contact that she gets with the school administrators. I, as a parent, love the response that I always get from all of the teachers whenever there's a question or anything concerning homework or other extracurricular activities or just what's going on in the school because I heard something and I need to get an answer. I usually get that information right away. And I think that's really, really important. I think there's probably a lot of parents in here with a lot of kids, and that's the most precious thing in your life. So you want to know exactly what's happening with your child at all times, and you want to know the first sign of trouble so you can do something about it. And I like the fact that the people, the students, the staff, the teachers, we're all partners in terms of making sure everything gets handled the way that it's supposed to get handled. My daughter has had the opportunity to attend non-charter Pasco County schools, and we actually find that Union Park is far better than the schools that she's actually had an opportunity to attend. So it's really important. She's gonna be there next year in the seventh grade and the year following in the eighth grade. So I really think it's really important, despite whatever financial situations currently exist, that they be rectified. The school gets a five-year charter. Because obviously you're gonna hear from a lot of people today whose kids are very much positively impacted by what the staff and what the teachers are doing at Union Park Charter Academy. Thank you.
Thank you. Gladys George, followed by Valerie Cole.
Good morning. Gladys George, 31217 Flannery Court, Wesley Chapel, 33543. I am a first grade parent. My son Caleb started Union Charter Academy when he was in kindergarten, and my goal for him was to finish in the school K through 8, as most parents, I think, would. From the beginning, Union Park has impressed me with the community model. We have members of our community, doctors that I work with. His BPK teacher actually referred us to Union Park. So the sense of community that the school shows our children and teaches our children is very much fluid in our experience there. Given that I am an ICU nurse, the past year has been very difficult for me. I've juggled the fear of COVID. I've juggled homeschooling my son, and I could not do it without Union Park. I'm a little emotional as well. The peace officer calling my son to check up on him, the school nurse calling us to check up on us, that's something that I can't thank them enough for bringing a sense of normalcy to our family. My son is still struggling with some of the issues with having to be forced to be homeschooled, and Union Park has absolutely gone above and beyond to assure us that he is safe, that we are safe. There. And being here today is a testament to the fact that we want our school to stay. We want our children to grow there. I want to continue volunteering. I need the school as much as my son does. I want to see his classmates grow. And so I'm here to please ask you to please consider more than a year's worth. We need time to fix the issues. Wesley Chapel as a community is growing and changing, and allow us the opportunity to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you. Valerie Cole, followed by Emily Rodriguez, looks like.
Good morning, Board Chair, and to the School Board District for the supporting staff. My name is Valora Cole, 6720 East Fowler Avenue, Suite 161, Tampa, Florida, 33617. Thank you so much for this great opportunity to share my concerns regarding the unexpected recommendation to renew our school for only 1 year. I'm also the board chair of this particular Florida Charter Educational Foundation. I first would like to say we have a very strong board and a very supportive management company that, like you all, are very concerned about our students, our parents, and certainly this amazing community of Pasco County. As you know, statutes are clear as to why a school should be renewed for only 1 year. Union Park Charter has met all criteria to be renewed for 5 years. In the initial memo I received from the superintendent, the following statement was included. Over the last two operational years in the term of the charter, independent financial audits conducted in accordance to FS 1002.339J disclosed no negative findings, and the charter school has not been required to complete a financial emergency or financial recovery plan. Also, over the same period, statewide accountability school grades were received as follows, as you all have stated. 2018-19 grade of A, 2019 through 2020, unreported due to pandemic, for years of operation. That statement clearly shows that we have met all criteria for a 5-year renewal accordance to statute. However, that statement was removed and the memo was revived when the superintendent sent the latest update. So in closing, thank you so much for considering the work that we've already done from the parents and considering extending that contract to 5 years. Thank you.
Thank you. So next would be Emily Rodriguez, followed by Maria Duque. And just so you know, we're not taking any additional cards at this point. We don't have time for all of them that we have. So, Emily? Maria? And then after that would be Jennifer Roman.
Good morning for everybody. My name is Maria Duque, 2624 Player Circle, Apartment 1, Lute, Florida, 33559. Okay, but Union Park Charter Academy, it is a school that provides security, integral formation, teacher with vocation and commitment. Quality of staff, responsibility, good attitude, dedication, discipline, values, social formation, artists, scientific, and sport. Collaboration between the school and parents, technology, education, teaching and second language, Spanish. Responsibility and dedication in special education. The building for children and the UPCA family. It is the school where your children and we as parents feel happy and calm. Their academic training, their methodology, commitment, kindness, professionalism, and their love for each student. They are the key tools for a successful student. I want to thank Ms. Morales, Ms. Land, teacher, or the UPCA family administrative staff for making this coming true. God bless you. God bless you always. Sincerely, family Nino Duque. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Emily? I thought I saw something. Okay. All right. Jennifer Roman, followed by Annie Cespedes.
My name is Jennifer Roman.
Address is 2409 Willamette Drive, Wesley Chapel, Florida, 33543. I'm here today to represent my family and express our support for Union Park Charter Academy. My family and I relocated to Wesley Chapel, and our two daughters' education was top priority. We visited multiple schools zoned to our address, including Union Park Charter Academy. After meeting with all the schools, we felt the staff at Union Park made the biggest impression, and we felt it was the best decision for our children. Although we felt it was the best decision, based on the things we heard and saw, it was a difficult decision because it was the school's first year in operation. At this point, looking back, my husband and I can most certainly say we made the best decision in choosing Union Park. The school is responsive with parents caring for our children, and as a business owner of Juice Factory, we've seen firsthand their support for local businesses and the community. Out of the many community events Union Park has engaged in, one event in particular was the support of our local firefighters. Seeing them happy because of the support they were receiving was priceless. There are many reasons we show our support, but the biggest reason is the care and education they provide to our children. As we were struck with COVID last year, the school's efforts and response were beyond amazing. The school has proven and continues to uphold their A-rated quality, and we are extremely happy there. Our children love the school, the staff, and their friends. We believe Union Park, our families, and the community deserve stability. We strongly support a 5-year renewal, and we all deserve nothing less. Thank you.
Thank you. Annie? And then Elaine, IWA, and I can't read the last three letters. Be next, and then Jennifer Boykin after that.
Good morning. My name is Annie Cespedes, 1740 Tallulah Terrace, Wesley Chapel, Florida, 33543. I have two kids in APCA. APCA has had an incredible positive impact in my kids and family. For the first time in my life, I feel involved in my kids' education. APCA's approach to education is to collaborate with us, the parents, to design a personalized plan for each student based on each student's needs. For instance, my daughter was struggling with fractions in math, and she was failing the class. Her teacher worked with us. She took the time to go over the material, and right now my daughter has an A in math. For all of us, the past year has been challenging to say the least. Some of us have lost friends and family members to this pandemic. Our family lives are not the same, and everything is in constant state of flux. It has been an entire year where the only constant has been my kids' school. I'm here to ask, to plead for a 5-year renewal instead of 1-year renewal. We need stability. My family needs stability. Please don't make us also have to have a plan B for our kids' school. Thank you. The Cespedes family.
Thank you. Elaine, Platinum Drive, Tampa,
Hello, I'm Elaine Iwasa, 10740 Plantation Bay Drive, Tampa, Florida, 33647. My son Bodie is 7 years old and in second grade. This is his first year at Union Park Charter Academy. He's an active boy who would rather be doing handstands and running around than sitting and focusing. He went to a traditional non-charter school in Hillsborough County for kindergarten and first grade. He's not impaired enough. He has some learning disabilities, but he's not impaired enough to be considered special needs. Because he was so frustrated and with not being able to keep up, though he's probably about 6 to 8 months behind his peers. He was not able to work independently. He would distract other children, and when he got frustrated, he would act inappropriately. I tried for 2 years to work with that school, and they were supportive, but they were very restricted in what they could offer. What he really needed was to be separated from the other children that were working at a much higher level than him. Because he would get overwhelmed and discouraged and then begin to act out very quickly. The thing that appealed to me about Union Park was that they did separate the children, that he's been in a group where he is comfortable. They also test regularly, and then they find out areas of weakness, and they have something called RTI, which every day they will focus on what the children are in that group are struggling on. I would urge you to renew Union Park's charter for 5 years so that they don't have to have that stress hanging over their head, and so that they can focus all of their attention on helping children. Thank you.
Thank you. Jennifer Boykin, followed by Jade Friedrich.
Good morning. My name is Jennifer Boykin. I'm at 5901 Estes Lane, Wesley Chapel, 33545. This is my son. He is in kindergarten. He's 5 years old, so he's a young kindergarten. He suffers from separation anxiety. He would cry every day in car line to get out of the car. This has been happening since he was three. UPCA has literally opened their arms around him. He feels secure. He wants to go to class. He, again, you know, like everyone else is saying, he's very, very active. Sitting down is not his thing. The teachers came up with different ways to meet those needs, not just to meet those needs, but to get him back to where he needed to be with the rest of the class. So he wouldn't always feel like he was separated back into the mainstream. I understand that there could be financial issues that are going on. Those things can be resolved. 1 year is difficult to do that. The more important thing for me and for my son, who has literally just is holding on to this school as part of his family, is just to have the stability and to know where we are going next year. Thank you.
Thank you. Jade Friedrich, followed by, looks like Perla on Passing Pine Lane.
Hi, my name's Jade Frederick. My address is 32676 Natural Bridge Road in Wesley Chapel, 33543. Good morning and thank you for allowing me a few minutes. I am a mother of three sons, a 15-year-old that attends Wiregrass High School, a 12-year-old and an 8-year-old that have attended Union Park Charter Academy since its opening in 2018. As with any new school, it hasn't been without its challenges, but I have seen the progress and have watched Ms. Morales and the rest of the teachers and staff mold this school into a successful, inclusive, caring environment that supports each other and the community. My 12-year-old had a very challenging start to his academics, beginning in preschool all the way through third grade. He was struggling academically, not behavior, but academically. My husband and I reached out and paid for him to be tutored and evaluated multiple times throughout the years with little success. I was watching him fall further and further behind each school year. We made the decision to pull him out of public school and paid for private school in Pasco County. He received outstanding support there. They were able to figure out that he had an auditory issue that was preventing him from reading and comprehending things that you and I find very easy to understand. He now had an IEP to follow and begin to catch up to his grade level. Like many families, sending him to a private school put a lot of strain on us financially, so I knew this would only be a short-term solution for us. That next summer, we saw in our very own neighborhood that Union Park Charter Academy was being built. We decided to take the chance, and we have made the best decision we have ever made for our son academically. Union Park has not only been able to meet my son's IEP, they continue to go above and beyond for my son and every single child that enters those doors. They embraced my son, and with calm and caring skill that has empowered my son to be confident and succeed. Please allow the management company the opportunity to correct its financial issue and provide the stability to our school. And please renew that charter for 5 years to provide us all the stability that we greatly need. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Perla? Did I say that halfway right?
Yes, you did.
And then Jacqueline Justice, and then looks like Darnell Taylor after that.
Perla Colangelo, 5630 Passing Pine Lane, Zephyr Hills, Florida, 33541. To begin with, thank you so much just for being here. Just the fact of being here is very important. I am here because I am a happy parent and a very happy employee of Union Park Charter Academy, AKA UPCA. where teaching is a pleasure, I must say. Very happy because the school has given me, my family, my daughter, the opportunity to grow. I consider it, with all the schools that I have been around, I consider it a very small school, but with a lot of love, a lot of potential. I have an 11-year-old. I started with UPCA. UPCA opened in August, and I started in January. And ever since then, it has been my home. And today, we are here because all of us, all the parents that are here, my principal, who has worked very hard, our assistant principal, who has also worked very hard for this. And I would really love for this to be a 5-year renewal versus to a 1-year, just because UPCA's my family. And we need the school. All of us are truly supportive of this place. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jacqueline Justice. And then Darnell, looks like Taylor after that.
Good morning. Good morning. Jacqueline Justice, 32155 Watoga Loop, Wesley Chapel, 33543. I currently have a kindergarten, a fifth grade student that attend Union Park Charter Academy. I'm a very active parent on the fundraiser and academic committees, and I'm here to voice my support for a 5-year renewal for our school. We came to UPCA 3 years ago in search of a school to help my struggling then second grader to prepare him for next year's dreaded statewide testing. When my son was in second grade, we began to see deficiencies in his learning. He started scoring below grade level on assessments, and even though he was excelling on his classwork. We met with his teachers to discuss his progress, and we never left a single conference with hope that my son was going to get what he needed to close the learning gaps that were beginning to grow larger and larger. My husband and I then started to look into other options to better fit my son's needs. We started doing our research and found that our county was opening a charter school that had an extended school day, free tutoring for struggling students, a community-based learning environment, and a technology-infused learning experience. We knew we had to get him into this school. We were quickly accepted through the lottery system, and my son began his third grade year at UPCA. Let me remind you that he was a struggling student, and we were looking for extra support. He attended the first two sessions of after-school tutoring that year, and come testing time, he was ready and prepared. After 1 year at UPCA, my son went from a struggling student to scoring a 4 on his FSA. My son is proof that great things are happening at UPCA. Being a very active parent on the academic and fundraising committee, I get to see firsthand how much this school means to our students, our teachers, our parents, and our community. With each growing year, that parent and community involvement just blows us away. Every fundraiser tops the last, and we aren't done yet. Our school, students, and community need this school to stay around for many years to come. Our students are happy, healthy, and flourishing. Please consider UPCA for a 5-year renewal and give our teachers, staff, and students the stability that they need to continue to grow and do amazing things at our school.
Thank you. And then next would be Jessica. And then, well, you go ahead and I'll figure out the day.
Good morning. Darnell Taylor, 1578 Tallulah Terrace, Wesley Chapel, Florida, 33543-7218. To Superintendent Browning, Deputy Superintendent Gadd, Chairman Altman, Board Members Armstrong, Woodwan, Harding, and Attorney Alfonso. Anyone else I may have forgotten? I'm crumbly. I'm Darnell Taylor, a resident of Pasco County for over 20 years, and I am here as a mother who has multiple children in this school to express my strong support for Union Park Charter Academy to receive a 5-year charter renewal. I am more than thankful for this opportunity for my children to attend this great school. This school focuses on the greatest path for each of the children that attend and design the lessons taught according to the standards set by the Board of Education, the definitions of excellence given by Pasco County Schools, and the needs and developments for each child or children. I'm asking that you strongly consider renewing this charter school for at least 5 years. The return on investment in the children they support will tremendously afford the kids an opportunity to be great in the community. On average, it takes 5 years to see a positive ROI, or return on investment, when started a business of any kind. With this school, the ROI, or the return on investment, has been immediate for my family and the community. After entering UPCA and getting the dedicated teaching and lessons designed for success, I now have two junior National Honor Society students who want to learn more and more each day. As the pandemic hit across the globe and the platform for education had to shift, UPCA did not lose a beat with their students. This school had a platform ready for immediate shift. 3 minutes already?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Please consider 5 years on the return on investment for the community with UPCA. Thank you.
Jessica. And then the next card, the last name, M-U-S-S-E-T. I apologize, I can't read the first one, but.
Jess Katie, 32317 Natural Bridge Road. I am here for a voice of support as a first-time, overly energetic kindergartner parent. When choosing EPCA, we needed a learning model that not only helped her grow up academically, but also met her social-emotional needs due to her chatty Kathy and rambunctious personality. The learning model within the community not only fits her desire to move around and explore several teachers throughout her day as to not lose interest, but also the ability to collaborate with her classmates, which UPCA strives on teamwork. I'm proud to say that my daughter is excelling on a quarterly basis while also encompassing the social aspect of school these young children so desperately need. This is not only evidenced not only in her progress reports, but more importantly in the loving community you see when entering the school each day. You see, UPCA's like a tight-knit community where everybody knows your name. When you drop off, you see the new leadership of Miss Morales, the principal, and Miss Land standing outside greeting each parent by name as they drive by. It's ran smoother than a Chick-fil-A drive-thru. In addition, these same friendly faces are there upon departure. What a great feeling each kid must have, leaving each day being shown how much they are loved and cared for. Let's touch a bit on the UPCA mission statement. We are dedicated to providing an innovative and collaborative learning model, as well as developing well-rounded global citizens. The first part is no secret that Union Park has been incredibly innovative in their approach to handling COVID this year. Not only have they followed all the increased cleaning and social distancing practices, they've been so innovative to maintain a normal school year. They have so many fun events, one being the daddy-daughter dance. That is so important. As a first responder, I had a fellow employee who lost her dad. One of the last things she said to me when I told her I was planning the dance was, I still have a picture of me and my dad sitting next to me on my nightstand from my first daddy-daughter dance, and that is the only thing I have left to remember him. So those events really are very important in continuing. Having these normalized events are not only fun, but they create the everlasting memories. UPCA has set the bar so high for all schools on just how innovative you can be to maintain normalcy in an otherwise hectic and unpredictable school year. The group of teachers and staff has set the standard with their time and commitment to the school and students, and they've done it so gracefully.
Please wind it up, please, ma'am.
Okay. I could go on to so many other events, but I really want to touch on bullying in a year that's so diverse.
I'm sorry, your two minutes are off.
Yeah. I'm sorry.
Next speaker. So tell me how to say it.
Westner Muset.
Okay.
Yep. Good morning, everyone. I'm here to support UPCA.
Address, I'm sorry.
I'm here to
your
support.
Address. Address for the record, I'm sorry.
2119 Shelbourne Court, Wesley Chapel, 33543. My experience, my daughter was UPCA since the first time it was open. We have a positive experience the whole time that she has been enrolled. Last year, especially with the pandemic and my wife's cancer diagnosis, they really stepped up and they were very accommodating and ensuring my daughter was getting a good grade education. And it was she kept up the good grade, and she has not missed one day of school, and she has excelled in all his academic. We have nothing but grateful, and we are looking for the 5 years extension. Please reconsider that. I'm also planning to enroll my son. He's 5. The teacher has been great, and our daughter truly enjoys going to school. She enjoys it with her friends, and how encouraged are the instructors. So please reconsider it. We love the schedule and the activity the school offer, but please make my daughter happy. It's going to be hard for me to tell them this school may be closed down. She's very happy, and like I mentioned, she's excellent grade, great instructor. Please reconsider 5 more years. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Amy U-Haul and then Fanny Shetland.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Amy U-Haul. I live at 4420 Yanes Court, Wesley Chapel, Florida, obviously. We talk about the 1 year. I am a business development officer in Pasco County. And anybody that's been in any kind of financial situation will tell you, 1 year is not enough to put this school back in a financial positive way. My husband is also a Pasco County Sheriff's Office, along with my father who's retired. We have one child that we fought to have, okay? His VPK got shut down in the middle of COVID. He didn't have anything to go learning from. We were starting Union Park because I needed the stability, I needed emotional support, and I needed to know that my one and only child was going to be loved when I'm not there. I pull into that car line, and teachers that are not teachers of my son know my son's name. I call because I'm a frantic parent that my child had an attitude that day, and the teachers are emailing me an hour later saying, Mrs. U-Haul, your child is fine. He had a bad day. That's okay. They are there to support us, not just our children, but the parents. I got quarantined. I dropped my kid off the first week of school on that Monday and got him back on Friday and cried. I said, wait, I didn't ask for him back yet. We were on Zoom with a 5-year-old. I was on Zoom. He was on Zoom. I was crying. He was trying to figure out, and I will tell you what, those teachers reached out to the parents, to the kids, to get us through it together. 1 year is not enough financially for us to get back on our feet. We need 5. And if anybody out here has ever applied for a loan, a business loan, you know it takes more than 1 year. I am asking that you give our children the emotional and social support and extending it to 5 years. Thank you so much.
Fanny Shetland and then Katie Casanova. Katie Reynolds, go ahead. We're running out of time.
Sorry, I'm Katie Casanova. I reside at 29524 Crossland Drive, Wesley Chapel, Florida, 33543. Good morning, and thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak in front of you. I'm a mother of 2 boys. My children have been attending Union Park for 3 years now and are currently in 4th and 7th grade. So the school has served us both as an elementary and a middle school. Through the past few years, there have been changes, but overall the foundation of the school has remained consistent in providing growth, transparency, and communication. They have also created a culture with an amazing ability to adapt. When COVID restrictions were put into place last year, the teachers and staff took great care by providing parents with not only constant emails and updates, but reached out personally via phone call to my children to let them know they were missed. Parents were promptly emailed Zoom codes, class schedules were sent out weekly to help us navigate this new routine, which was extremely helpful to us. And because the kids utilize the iPad on a daily basis anyway, they were already prepared with the proper technology and applications to connect, resulting in a seamless transition for a continuous structure even as they have gone back to in-person learning. Our family is very grateful for the opportunity to attend Union Park and the ability to obtain education, technology, and community. With your continued support and your 5-year renewal, Union Park will remain steady in growth while providing a quality education that supports traditional values. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Katie Reynolds, 4241 Rustic Pine Place, Wesley Chapel, Florida, 33544. Oh, what can I say? First of all, I just want to go back to Mike Bagley, one of our first speakers. I have four children. He has three. We have very similar age groups. And I want to reiterate what he said. The financial situation that Union Park might find itself in, I can tell you with all confidence that with Ms. Morales and Mrs. Land and Ms. Warren, who is driving those numbers daily, we can right this ship. We need the 5-year charter renewal so that my 4 8th grader, who's going on to high school and has thrived in her creative arts, and she's a star on that stage, and watching that passion as a mom is incredible. My 7th grader, who's social and athletic, who has this year really stepped into her own from a science and medical standpoint, being asked to be a part of a science camp. My 5th grader, who's getting ready to go into Union Park's middle school, and my 1st grader, who is, because of this data-driven model, light years being able to push his giftedness. So I am excited, and not only as a parent, but as an employee teaching physical education K-5. I get to see these kids on a daily basis, and I know that with this leadership that is in place right now, we've been from the beginning of the groundbreaking of the building all the way through today. I know that we can right this ship. We need the 5-year charter renewal. Thank you.
Thank you. Wyatt Washington, and then Fanny Shetland is, we're
hi,
passing
I
that
am
one.
Wyatt Washington, all right. 7940 Augusta Boulevard, Hudson, Florida, 34667. I've started this school since 6th grade at the very beginning. And my reading level was way behind, so was my math. And I am now leaving as an 8th grader, and I have seen a increase of 25% on my reading level and 18% increase in my math level. And I would just like to thank all of my teachers and the support of the school. And I would like to yield the rest of my time to the next person.
Thank you. Conrad, looks like Milne, and then after that, Mindy Washington.
Hi, Conrad Milne, 32096 Wenlock Loop, 33543. Hey, thanks for having us. Union Park had some issues the first year, and the second year we had this pandemic. But now we're under the leadership of Ms. Morales, and she's a strong leader, and I'm confident that they'll continue to grow and excel. If they're having financial issues and enrollment issues, then I suggest the board help. You can help them by giving them the stability of this 5-year renewal, as well as supporting them with enrollment. To be honest with you, I'm pretty shocked that enrollment's as low as it is. You heard everybody. It's a wonderful school. My kids have done great before in Double Branch. It was a wonderful school, too, and they're doing fine now. But it's just a great school overall. With all the new home construction around Union Park, and there's a lot, there's no doubt that enrollment's going to improve, and when that happens, so will the finances. Please continue to hold Charter School USA's feet to the fire on the finances. That's extremely important. Ms. Morales is a solid leader, and you need to put your faith in them by giving UPCA a 5-year renewal. We all have faith in Ms. Morales, and we think you should too. Thanks.
Thank you. Mindy Washington, followed by Adriana Silva.
Good morning, Mindy Washington, 7940 Augusta Boulevard, Hudson. I'm here on behalf of UPCA as both a 3-year teacher and the parent of that amazing young man that just out there, who's making me cry a little. I have been a teacher since 1997 when I started my career at Land O'Lakes High School. I've taught in public schools, I've taught in public public magnet schools, I've taught in private schools. 3 years ago, I had the opportunity to join in a brand new concept school. So when you talk about being not afraid to fail and not afraid to make mistakes, CSUSA, our parent company, was not afraid to try something bold and new. And numbers only tell part of the story. I'm gonna cry now because these people, we are family. I have worked in many different settings and I know the parents who are my volunteers, who work with my classes, but I don't know all the parents. But I know every one of these faces. I know every one of their children's faces. They're my babies. They're my big guys. And not only that, but I do not just have a relationship with my administrators. I have a relationship with Mr. Morris and Dr. Ruiz and Dr. Christensen, which is so unusual. I feel so supported, not only as an employee, but as a lifelong learner, as a parent. I feel supported by the entire structure. I feel that we are a great partnership with the district, and I feel that, as everyone has said, 1 year is not enough. We are committed. I'm committed to the next 5 years as an UPCA Comet. And if you grant us the 5 years, we will make a huge difference.
Adriana, followed by Talia.
Good morning. Adriana Silva, 4010 Medici Lane, Wesley Chapel, 33543. Well, my son Arthur joined the UPCA back in 2018 when he's starting at sixth grade. That was an easy transition since the school brought significant innovation and embracing environment. Comparing to his previous school, the space layout, technology, and welcoming staff quickly got his attention and preference. We all faced some challenges at the beginning because it was all new. But as a community, we overcame those. For the last 2 years, with a lot of transparency and proper parents' participation, we made UPCA a second home for our kids. And being close to the school as a volunteer, I can actually see the teachers and staff engaged and working with a positive attitude. This is what brings us outstanding results, making UPCA an A-rated school. We must recognize how fast and efficient the school moved into the virtual learning when the pandemic approached. And later, they came to us with a reduced capacity and a blended in-person and virtual options. That was a fantastic job, where everyone went above and beyond, adapting and supporting our kids' learning. Not only the formal learning, but they came with additional activities to engage both parents and kids into the virtual environment. We had family bingo, talent show, and everyone came together. I do support UPCA for 5 years contract renewal because we all expect and we all need a stability. Our kids' learning is a multiple year journey and we must have the UPCA management and staff focus it in making things better every day. Thank you.
Thank you. Talia? And then the next one, Asmet, looks like Mendez after that. All right, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Talia Acevedo. I reside at 30550 Pecan Valley Loop in Wesley Chapel, Florida, 33543. I currently have two daughters that attend Union Park Academy. This is their first year at the academy. There are many reasons why my husband and I chose this school, but let me highlight a few. First, I like that the school has smaller classroom sizes versus public schools where they're inundated with students over 30 per teacher. The smaller classrooms allow the teachers to provide more one-on-one attention to their students and help children in any gap that they have or any areas that they need additional help. The teachers are able to see each student and get better learning results. The students have more opportunities to participate, and the focus stays on learning rather than redirection. Second, I like that our students have the that they're ready for the future with technology, critical thinking, team building, and creativity. Technology is one of the most important tools that they need now and in the future, and the children use learning apps. Learning to navigate the platform enhances the learning experience. I am elated every day when I pick up my daughters from school and immediately hear about what they learn, in addition to their enthusiasm, excitement to go back the next day. My 7-year-old doesn't stop amazing me with how elaborate her vocabulary keeps growing. My 8th grader is using communication and team building skills as she works with others and builds trusting relationships with her teachers. Third, having my daughters attend a school that mandates the use of uniforms is a plus, not only convenient, but it also takes out competition, distraction, and social pressures from them. This allows them to focus on learning. With the growing pressures children are experiencing nowadays, it is reassuring to know that this is one less, and that they can see each other for who they are, and not for what they wear or measure up. UPCA is also a diverse school from teachers, staff members, and students. They get a real look at what normalcy looks like. And in addition, this school also provides a safe environment to my children. And I see my time is up, so I will stop. Thank you.
Thank you. So, Ms. Mendez?
Yes.
All right, and then followed by Mr. Ruiz.
My name is Esnavet Mendez, and I live in 3028 Hilliard Drive, Wesley Chapel, Florida. I am the mother of JC from 4th grade and Haley from 2nd grade. We joined Union Park Charter Academy back in 2019 when we moved from Lawrenceville, Georgia to Wesley Chapel. We were practically refused by Double Branch Elementary School, which is the school we are assigned based on our home address. I was treated by Double Branch staff poorly. They sent my kids home with the excuse that by law I could keep them home for that period of time. The person who was in charge for enrollment was sick, and that there was no one else who knew how to start the enrollment process for my daughters. I did not want my girls to miss 2 weeks of education, so a family member recommended UPCA, and we were welcome at the very first minute. The enrollment and lottery process were facilitated to us 100% from beginning to end. UPCA staff and administrator welcomed my girls into the school and showed us their concept and high technology campus. Ever since we joined UPCA, my kids have had excellent learning curriculum that includes art, music, drama, sports, coding courses, as well as many other extracurricular activities at very little or no cost to parents. We have had the benefit of not paying before care due to their early start. We feel we are part of a community where everyone is welcome and cared for. We chose UPCA not only because they are an A-rated school, but because we were treated with dignity and respect. I want you to ask, consider giving UPCA the 5-year full contract that they deserve, and because of the high performance. Displacement, as the gentleman previously mentioned, sounds worrisome to me. How do you think this will sound to our kids? Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Ruiz, followed by Jasmine Paris, and then Rosie Lungo.
Eddie Ruiz, reside at 13853 Geranium Place, Wellington, Florida, 33414. Chairman Altman, board member, superintendent, and staff, thank you for the opportunity to speak today. First, I just got to give a shout out to all the family of all the Union Park families that came today at 9:30 in the morning. May have missed work, may have done whatever it was to be actually here to speak today. They're awesome, and I appreciate them for being here today. With that said, I was going to have a lot of points here, but 2 minutes is not a long time, so I'm not going to say that. I think, board members, you received the email from, I believe, and the superintendent may have received the email with all our points. I will say, as the governing board chair, Ms. Cohn, mentioned in her comments, we really are at a loss of words as a staff of why we're only being recommended for 1-year renewal. As an A-rated school that has never been in a financial emergency as defined by Florida statutes, we have an independent auditor. They've done the audits. There's been no negative findings, really no basis for a 1-year renewal. The school is entitled to a full 5-year. Previous to this role, in 3 years as the Florida State Director, I oversee 64 schools in 13 school districts. I work with 13 school boards. I work with 13 charter offices. We've been operating for 20 years, and this has not been ever an issue. We did have a meeting yesterday. We did at a late yesterday meeting, we'll provide the documents necessary to show what we need to show for the school board to make the five-year determination. Independent auditors, they've given us the clean audits, and we're happy to work with staff, but a one-year renewal will really not help our school. It really will hurt our school. And so we really are asking for what we deserve, which is a five-year renewal. And I'll end with this. In previous role, I was the assistant superintendent in Palm Beach School District. We did close down a charter school that was mismanaging funds, that was stealing money. This is nowhere near that situation. And looking at all the information there, I've seen the early warning signs, and this is not nowhere near it. And I'm asking, please, for a five-year renewal. Thank you, board.
Thank you. Jasmine Paris. Rosie. Eugene Reynolds. Last call, Jasmine, Rosie, Eugene.
I think there's somebody coming.
Okay. Do what?
Rosie is here.
Oh, okay. Thank you for letting me know that.
Hola, buen día.
Good morning.
Mi nombre es Rosy Lugo.
My name is Rosy Lugo.
Vivo en la comunidad de Union Park.
I live in the community of Union Park.
Disculpa que me pongan así, pero vengo en apoyo al colegio.
I apologize for my
soy una mamá latina.
I am supporting
que llegó hace menos de tres años este país.
Y eso I have a little girl that came to this country
en el primer only año, 3 years. En el primer año de ago. Mis hijos en el colegio fue en el condado de Hillsboro, donde recibieron mucho bullying por no saber el inglés.
The first year of college, they were in Hillsboro County. They unfortunately received a lot of bullying
por ser latinos.
For not knowing English, for being Latin.
Por ser latinos. Y yo conseguí en este colegio un gran apoyo para mis hijos.
In this college, I received a great support for my children.
Donde ya saben hablar inglés.
They already know how to speak
donde
English.
Donde han conseguido el 100% en el apoyo, tanto en sus profesores y en todo el personal administrativo.
They have received a 100% support, not only from the administrators, but from the staff.
Y estoy muy orgullosa de que ellos sigan allí y deseo que su renovación sea por 5 años para que ellos puedan culminar todo lo que le quede de sus años escolares en ese colegio.
I am very proud because they are attending that school and I want the 5 year to be the renewal for 5 years so they can remain at that college.
Tuve el apoyo que no tuve en ese colegio en el programa ISO, donde ellos le pudieron dedicar el tiempo necesario a mis hijos para que aprendieran lo más rápido posible el idioma. Y le doy gracias a este país por habernos recibido, porque vinimos para una mejora para ellos, porque mi país está en una situación donde no podemos vivir aún.
They received support from the ISO department. They already learned the language, and I am greatly appreciative of their support because we came from a country that we could not stay at the, in that country any longer.
Gracias.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are you Eugene? You're last, buddy.
No pressure, right?
No.
Hi, thank you. My name is Eugene Reynolds. I live at 32501 Goddard Drive in Wesley Chapel. I live in Union Park. I wasn't planning on speaking, so I apologize. I have nothing prepared, but I heard the reason why you were considering not extending the 5 year, and I just wanted to reiterate that they do have new principal, you know, new staff that are going to improve that. If you looked at social media over the past few years, people were very dissatisfied with the way the school was going, but now it's changed under Miss Morales, and you know, like everyone else has said, everyone's really happy. The people that go there are really happy with the quality of the education. There's a lot of people moving to the area, so we really just implore you to extend it for 5 years. That's it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. So I'm going to use Chairman's prerogative, and I'm going to ask Ms. Tillman, thank you for being here. I don't want to make you or I sound old, but we might be one of the very few people in the room that remember the last time that we dealt with this and what ended up transpiring. So if you don't mind, could you, since they weren't addressed in any of the comments, could you please address the findings and concerns of your audit so that we hear it from you?
Yes, I'd be happy to discuss that. There were a few issues, you know, that Mr. Youngman had started discussing. Perfect. And some of the things that, you know, we had the overspending. Okay. I know I used to be short. This is worse. There was the overspending for the first 2 years. And, of course, the school's representative pointed out the fact that if you take out the bond and the restricted items and the depreciation, that they didn't overspend. Well, they did the first year. And the second year, they didn't overspend as much, but they still didn't come out of the hole that they were the year before. I have no doubt that Charter Schools USA has the resources to support the school, but we haven't really seen anything in writing that tells us that they are willing to do that, besides adjusting their management fee is the only thing that we've seen. They pointed out that the financial emergency, which that's a very specific thing, and basically that 218.503 talks about having missed tax payments or if you the withholding that the employers do for their employees when they withheld both the employer portion of the FICA and whatever they withheld from the employee's paycheck, if they fail to deposit that. These are the kind of things that register a financial emergency. And that is so far down the road. If that kind of thing happens, the place needs to be shut down right away. Clearly, that has not happened with this school. So it's very specific where what we're looking at are bigger picture items. The one thing that really came to my attention, and we saw this the year before in their review also and mentioned it, was the fact that they're not making budget amendments. You know, they're using the same budget for the entire year. So at the end of the year, you have the original budget that was based on the number of students that they expected to have at the beginning of the year, and then the money that they spent, they overspend. So their ending budget has a lot of over expenditures and it has too much revenue in it. So the problem with that is, as it's an obligation for anybody who's responsible for public funds to provide this level of transparency and accountability over money. So the conversation that we had yesterday, we talked about this fact, and they told me that that they have another instrument that they use that is a forecasting that they do adjust based on how many students are enrolled. And I said, where is that? You know, clearly that's not presented to the public. And the board does not vote on this, and it's not included in your final audit report. So, you know, that I don't maybe I didn't understand it, or maybe they didn't explain it thoroughly, but it almost sounded like it was something that they were almost keeping a separate record. Well, you know that's not how we work. And again, these are public funds. We are totally accountable to the public for all of these things. So this all needs to be in the open. And I know that Charter Schools USA, you know, anytime I ask a question, they're always very happy to give me their resume of how many schools they run and how successful they've been. And I know that Charter Schools USA either has the resources or they can certainly acquire the resources to do these things correctly. So that was the my main comment about the budgets. They also, I had asked for some procedures manuals. They gave me their grants manual, with a very tiny amount of their revenue that comes into that school comes from grants. It's mainly FEFP money, just like ours. So I asked for the procedures over funds that are not grant funds. And again, I got their resume, you know, for how much they spend, you know, how many schools they have and all these things. Never got the information that I asked for. Let me see what else there was. Oh, and the other thing was the renewal document, which is what this renewal is supposed to be based on, is that renewal document that they gave us. And one of the things I looked at was their budget, their five-year projected budget. And they projected their budget based on 765, I'm doing this from memory, 765 students, which is way over 100 more than they have now, which, again, just does not seem reasonable based on where they are now and the fact that they are overspent, that they should be looking at budgets that are more reasonable. They're starting with a budget that's probably too high for them to actually attain. So that was another one of my comments. And let's see. Oh, and then the other thing is, when I was looking at the five-year budget, they had like two different schedules. And one had how they determined how much they budgeted in each expenditure category. And they took like a percentage of revenue for each one, which, you know, was looked like a good way to budget. And then I went to the five-year budget and I tried to recalculate what they had done, and I couldn't recalculate it. And they told me that there were only the most significant expenditure items were in the budget, that not everything was there. Well, again, we're talking about transparency here. I don't know how to analyze budgets when all the numbers aren't there. And again, seems like Charter Schools USA should know how to do this and should know how to present it so that anybody could look at this and understand it. I think that's all I have. Do you have any questions on that?
Do what?
Do you have any questions on that?
I'm going to open it up for board members to see if any of them had any.
Well, sure. I can start, I guess. Okay. I kind of have a statement and then some questions, I guess.
Okay.
I would like to speak to all the parents who have come. We particularly appreciate engaged parents, believe me. Those are the parents we love. And nobody here on our board wants to close a school ever. We don't like to close schools. And that's really why we're having the conversation here. And it's crystal clear to me, the parents of UPCA love your school, and your children appear to be flourishing. And we are, as Mary explained, we are also the stewards of the taxpayer dollar, and that all has to be transparent and clear, and that's part of what our job in the Florida Constitution, that's one of our requirements. So as Chairman Altman was alluding to, we have seen some in the past where a charter school has had to be closed, and it is extremely agonizing for students, parents, everybody involved. And we're here because we really don't want that to happen. Okay, so understand that. And also, I guess my question is, I haven't seen or heard from really anybody on the board of this school. And like the school I had mentioned earlier in the meeting that I had visited, Day Spring Academy, that's one of our partner charter schools. They have a very active local board, and they are very involved in the budgeting and all those things. So I'm just curious if there is a plan for, I mean, I understand you've mentioned that the new principal is on this and other folks, but is there any type of a plan that has been put forward that we can, you know, look at and analyze, so to speak? Does that make sense? That we need to know the direction and how that's going to be fixed? Do we have any information on that?
The board,
Yeah.
I was going to ask that same question of her as to how they plan on correcting the budget. I mean, it is something that as board members, we actively say, okay, we've got X amount of money that we've got to cut from the budget to have a balanced budget at the end of each year. I just wondered what their board plan is to help correct these deficits. If maybe she could come up to the podium.
Thank you again for this opportunity in reconsidering.
Well, first of all, as we said, we have a very strong board that we oversee the school in support of our principals. We also have public notice meetings, and then the board has a treasurer who reviews all of the financial information. He's actually a financial executive at one of the banks there in Fort Lauderdale. So he goes over all of the financials with the accounting department before our board meetings. And so we go over those as well. We accept the budget as given. And so those things also, we have been able to, I think there was a meeting on yesterday where they began to talk about the adjustment. And I don't think it was 795. I think it was about 700 or so that we were projecting in our budget. So it wasn't as much as I think was stated. So that's something that we're always aware of. As I said, we have a very strong and supportive management company that has foregone their fees because, you know, when you're starting a school, it takes more money. And so we want to ensure that the school is successful, that they have the financials that they need, they have the support that they need. So we put more into a new school because it requires more, it needs more. And especially with everything that has gone on with COVID this past year, there's just been a lot of adjustments, things that you don't expect, but you have to expect what you don't expect. So one of the things that has really been so profound is our academic system that we implement. We implemented the OWL system as a part of Zoom. And so it's been an amazing system where the kids that are at home actually get a 3D image of the school, of inside the classroom. They're able to participate as in within the classroom. It's an amazing system. So we've really tried to do as much as possible, even exceed things that even the district schools were doing. So in hope of making sure that each child had the best opportunity possible in learning. We certainly pride ourselves on individualized learning for our children because we understand everyone is different. They have various needs, and so we're there to make sure those needs are supplied, so to give them the best opportunity for education. And so we continue to review ourselves and what we do every single month. We have a board meeting. We go to the various schools pre-COVID, so now they're mainly done on Zoom, but every single month, we have a board meeting and we're going over the financials, we're going over the academic health of our schools and to make sure that we have everything that we need.
Okay, so my question was, and you know, if your enrollment dropped, and I mean, we had the same issue here, our enrollment dropped, but we then looked, okay, we have this much less money to spend this year. So we had to, we got federal money, state money. You received that same portion right. per student that we did. But then we looked and said, okay, where do we have to make adjustments in our budget to make sure we still have a balanced budget? Right. And that is reviewed. We have budget amendments every month that shows how our revenue has adjusted, how our expenditures have adjusted. That is something that is done on a monthly basis, and we've had to make some tough decisions. So my question was, the past is a past, but moving forward, what is the board's plan? How do you plan not to spend more money, how do you plan to either improve revenue or reduce expenditures so that you can reach a balanced budget this coming year?
Okay, thank you. We work with our finance team. We also work with the treasurer, and the board reviews those items during that. So we do that. And then we look and see, okay, in what areas do we need to focus on? Perhaps we can pull back on certain things so that we can ensure that those items are budgeted, that we have the balanced budget that is needed. So that's something we're constantly looking at and working with our treasurer, working with the finance team at our corporate office. So they give a report every single month. We go over those items. In what we're looking at, we see all of the expenditures that, you know, for each school. So the principal is also there, the assistant principal, and any supporting staff that is on that meeting as well. It's public, so anyone can attend. And so that's something that we're doing to ensure and to look at each of those items to see where there is a deficit and how we can accommodate that deficit.
Ms. Bogan has been patiently waiting, so I'm going to let her ask some questions.
Okay, I have some comments. I have my question is for staff.
So okay.
She doesn't need to stay up there. First, I too want to recognize and acknowledge the many emails that we received and the families here today. I've actually visited this school in the past, and I understand that many of the parents are happy with the school. I'm pleased that families are having this positive experience. And I agree with what one of the parents suggested, that the decrease in students could be COVID-related. That's not the significant concern for me. It's the fiscal concerns. We have a responsibility to make sure that the school and their board are fiscally responsible. And there are many concerns, as staff has shared. A one-year contract is a measure that could be taken to give them time to take these corrective steps, so that it does not become an emergency that could lead to more significant consequences. Mr. Youngman and Superintendent, I'll come back to you for 1 minute, I'm sorry. I don't understand why it would take 5 years to start making regular budget amendments. I would think that that's something that could immediately be implemented. So Mr. Youngman and the Superintendent, if we approve a one-year contract, and they make these all the corrective measures that staff is recommending, could you bring back a contract for 5 years at that time if they do everything that we're asking?
Mr. Chairman, if I may, well certainly if they meet the criteria for a five-year contract, we would bring a five-year contract back to the board. What this superintendent's looking for is fiscal controls. Right. That moving forward, that if they followed those fiscal controls and even an accounting procedures manual that would kind of drive their financial accounting processes, that it would keep them on a sound financial footing. I will tell you again, as I said in my opening comments, I am not just with Union Park, but with any charter school, I am always concerned about the fiscal concerns or positions of a school, because eventually there's a great possibility, depending on the school, the leadership, that we assume the responsibilities and the liabilities of that school. I want to reiterate one final thing. I'll say it again. I am not questioning the loving, caring environment of Union Park Charter Academy. Not at all. Matter of fact, I agree almost without exception from our parents today. This is about financial stability of this charter school. I believe, by giving them the one-year contract now, gives them time to get their financial house in order before we think about granting a five-year contract. I'm not out to close Union Park, but I am out to get them on sound, or give them the opportunity for they themselves to get on firm financial footing.
Just in response to what you said, Mr. Ruiz reminded me that they have created a budget amendment that's going to their board on Thursday. So 2.5 years later, the same week of this meeting, they're now doing their first budget amendment. So yes, it can be done.
Quickly, I thought.
Okay.
So. Thank you.
One other thing, we've certainly worked diligent with our marketing team, and so we have a new digital marketing program that is being implemented even now to get more students into the school, to bring awareness to our communities as well. So that's already been started, and we're actually looking for great results for our visiting.
So were you on the call yesterday?
No, sir, I was not.
Okay. So Ms. Tillman, Mr. Young, I'm assuming we use the same exact, regardless of the age of the school, that we use the same criteria when you do your audits and examinations
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So the other schools that have recently opened are falling under the same?
Everybody, same
okay.
one.
All right, thank you.
Can I make a comment?
Yes. Most certainly.
I also wanted to reiterate what my colleagues had said, and that I too have received all the emails from parents this weekend and some phone calls. And it's very obvious that Union Park is very loved and the students are excelling, and the families who chose to go there love their educational experience their children are getting. And with that being said, I think you heard from all my colleagues, like, we want you to be successful. We want you to be able to fix these mistakes. And we are going to give you 1 year to fix up your budget for fiscal transparency. And so I do look forward to seeing that amended contract coming back with all the fixes that we've asked you to do. So thank you.
Yeah. I move to approve.
Second.
All right, we have a motion to approve the superintendent's recommendation by Bowdoin. Second was Harding. Any discussion? Let me just, I guess, make a comment that for parents and board members and administrative staff, I don't think that anything I've heard today is asking anybody to get in a net position to make overnight changes. But I think what you've heard is a staff and a group that are willing to give the time to demonstrate that you're making progress. And what we, and I think Ms. Tillman would refer to as institutional controls, and make sure that that we do that. So we have a motion and a second. Any additional discussion by board? All in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Thank you.
Thank each of you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for being here. So, board members, I need a motion to
take an off agenda item 15.6 from early childhood programs.
Thank you.
So moved. Second.
She motioned.
Second.
Harding second.
Sorry.
To take an off agenda item. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. All right. Then 15.6, early childhood grant.
I move to approve the recommendation for the grant. 15.6 from early childhood program.
Second.
Motion by Bowdoin, second by Harding. Any discussion? All in favor signify by aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes. Thank you.
15.7 is
what?
Oh, I thought it was 15.6.
Oh.
Oh, okay. So I moved to take off agenda item 15.7. From early childhood programs.
Second.
Motion by Bowdoin, second by Harding. Any discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes 15.7.
Motion to approve.
But okay,
it's the other early
You're
childhood
right.
program grant.
Okay. So motion by Bowdoin, second by.
One is early Head Start, one is Head Start.
Okay.
Harding, second.
Second.
All right, second by Harding. All in favor, aye.
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 Motion passes. Turn the sound off. Board member reports. Ms. Bowdoin.
I attended FSBA Day in the Legislature, met with many of my colleagues, Representative Chris Letvala and Representative Randy Maggard, about legislative concerns. I sent numerous emails to representatives and senators about Senate Bill 86 and the many concerns I have about it. I realize it has been amended and that the career contingencies and penalties for post-secondary credits earned in high school have been removed, but there's still concern about the wording and if the funding will continue to be there for our bright future students. The wording that is being proposed, as I understand it, is removing the 175% award value from statute. Families have expressed concern that the funding could go away or be limited, and the students might not receive what they have earned and planned for. Additionally, it appears that the funds will come from general appropriations rather than lottery funds, which continue to be healthy. I share these concerns and would like to see the bill withdrawn or vetoed by the governor. It was a, switching gears here, it was a pleasure to visit Pineview Middle School and see the students work. Mrs. Summerall's Studio 2 and Studio 3 art students have been working very hard to solve personal and world problems through their Innovation Creation Unit, which was funded and inspired by Pasco Education Foundation's 2020 Innovative Classroom Project. Students were tasked to research personal and world problems and then use their creative thinking skills to imagine an innovation or invention that would help students solve problems. They constructed prototypes, made advertisements, commercials, and PowerPoint presentations to go with their prototypes. They even had QR codes that when I was going around, you know, you could scan it on your phone and see their presentations and commercials. The students are competing in a contest like Shark Tank. There were multiple best of categories and an overall winner. So well done, Panthers, and thank you to Mrs. Summerall for this outstanding interdisciplinary unit. Again, I wanted to mention that I virtually met with the students at John Long Middle School in the civics class with Commissioner Mike Moore. And I want to let everyone know that civics is alive and well in Pasco County. I had another meeting with our Cognia accreditation team. I'm part of the leadership team. We got through about half the domains. We reviewed the documentation that was collected, made recommendations of additional documentation that could be provided, discussed the rubric and evidence, and scored each section, and we plan to meet again to go through the remaining domains. I attended Land O'Lakes High School musical, Next to Normal, at Heritage Park Amphitheater. There were some very heavy topics addressed, including mental health and suicide. The students put on an outstanding performance. I want to congratulate the students and thank their directors for the countless hours they have dedicated to these students. I also want to mention National Assistant Principals Week this week, and thank you to all our amazing Pasco County Schools assistant principals. I also want to thank the principals, assistant principals, and all the school-based staff who are planning creative ways to recognize the class of 2021. While I am not one who usually believes in the every kid gets a trophy philosophy, I do believe that this year's class of students has had to deal with a lot of obstacles and disappointments. They missed out on the last quarter of their junior year, and they have had their entire senior year disruptive. I hope that we can recognize many students for their achievements. I want to thank Leah Mitchell and Vonette Chandler for working with the University of Tampa team to find ways to increase the number of people who have the credentials to hold leadership positions in our district. Great leaders inspire teachers and have direct impact on student success. This is a unique and exciting opportunity for our teachers. UT is providing a high-quality program with flexible options in person, hybrid, and remote for teachers who want to earn a master's degree, as well as for those who have a graduate degree and need only the additional coursework for their certification. Mrs. Mitchell identified this as a need because we have several terrific teacher leaders in Pasco who already have master's degrees, and so I'm looking forward to this collaboration and growing more leaders in our district. And finally, thank you to Melissa Musselwhite and her team and all the staff for their efficient COVID vaccination plan. I'm very grateful for your work to get all our employees vaccinated who want to be, and I heard nothing but praise about how smoothly everything has gone, so thank you very much.
Miss Hardy, that's what I meant when I was.
Oh, I was like, what did you do?
Then if I was still tied up, you were next.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry.
I got to spend a beautiful morning before spring break at Marchman Technical College for a book signing. Chris Angelia, a student in Kim Taylor's Adults with Exceptionalities class, wrote and published his first book entitled Dottie's Freckles. It was such an honor to attend and meet this amazing young man. I wanted to congratulate Chris, and I highly recommend the book Dottie's Freckles. It has a great message of we're all different, embrace it. It's available on Amazon. I purchased one and I got my very own signed copy, so if you get one, he'll sign it for you. I also got the opportunity to speak to Representative Chris Latvala along with Representative Maggard to advocate for our district. I continue to write emails to our representatives and have phone calls. I wanna thank Wayne for helping us get these meetings set up since we cannot be in Tallahassee this year. I also spent some time volunteering at Gulf Highlands in kindergarten last week, as well as some time at Northwest in pre-K. I too want to reiterate Ms. Bodwin's thanks to Melissa Muswhite and her team for the vaccination clinics. I know you've been working around the clock so hard, and I'm so appreciative of it. I know that this week we've started state testing, and as a former third grade teacher, I know firsthand that this season comes with a lot of anxiety and stress for our students and our teachers and staff. And this year, I know it's a little bit more heightened. So I wanted to remind our teachers, staff, and students how proud I am of them. Every single one of you have given your all, and although the information we're gathering is really important for us, please remember that you're more than just one test. I know I have said this before, but our teachers, staff, and administrators and students that we have in Pasco County are the best, and I'm so grateful and appreciative of every single one of you. That's it.
Thank you. Ms. Crumley?
Well, I mistakenly gave my board member report during my committee report time, so sorry about that.
That works.
But I did also attend the Representative Maggard Zoom call-in. That was very good.
All right, thank you. Ms. Armstrong.
All right, need to make a correction, because I want to make sure that Wayne Birch is recognized for all the work he does for the legislature mm-hmm. and keep us informed, and that Steve Haggerty is not Wayne Birch. When I said he helped us with the platform, it was Wayne Birch that helped us with that. So I've been very involved with attending the Zoom meetings with our legislators and with FSBA on legislative issues as far as writing legislators and so on. I'll stop at that for today. We're short on time.
Do what?
I said I'll stop at that since we're short on time.
Yeah, I'm gonna skip all mine stuff too and move on. Last thing, Madam Attorney, any comments today?
I do not have any comments.
All right, if you would take us to the next part of public comment. We've got a few cards and then we're gonna finish up.
We have a 1-minute restroom break. Is that possible?